Hello friends, welcome to CYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently, we have 12 series that target your prelims, and one series that target your mains, and one series that is dedicated to the history optional test series. So those students who are from history optional, they can join our test series. We have just started our history optional test series yesterday. So yesterday was the first test, and those students are willing to join that test series, they can contact us. And now let's come to the prelims oriented series, friends, that we are running on our channel. So currently we have 12 series. So what we do, we daily cover two series. So in this manner, two topics are discussed, and nearly 10 to 15 topic of 15 questions of each topic are discussed. And in this manner, nearly 20 to 30 questions combined of two topics are covered daily. And we have started 12 prelims oriented series. So whole syllabus has been divided into 12 subtopics, or for that matter series. So we daily cover two, and in 6 days we cover 12. So in this manner, we continue this process in a cyclic manner, and we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is the prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and friends, we will end this series only one day before your exam. So let's start our discussion. So today is lecture number 12 of geography. So the first question is, you will observe that rainfall generally shows a reducing pattern when moving from equator to the poles. This is due to change in solar insolation, B, presence of intermoraneal periods, C, formation of wavy isotherms at equator, D, movement of jet streams along the way. Let me tell you, friends, that the rainfall is observed in rainfall goes on decreasing from equator to poles. This is basically due to the change in solar insolation. At the equator's insolation is high, so the evaporation is high, so also the rainfall is also high. But in case of poles, the insolation is not that much, incoming solar radiation is not that much, so that's why evaporation doesn't take place, and that's why we do not see much rainfall in these polar areas. So answer is A, so solution is A. So already I have provided you in detail explanation. So there are two types of pattern, that is rainfall reduces from coastal areas to the interiors of continents, and also it decreases from equator to the pole parts. So already I have given you the explanation. So let's move on to the second question. Second question is, the expansion created by Big Bang continues even to the present day. Reason, soon after the Big Bang, the universe became highly opaque and temperature started rising till the atmosphere was formed. So we have to choose the correct answer. Let me tell you, friends, that yes, assertion is correct. That's the Big Bang theory in which it is proposed that a Big Bang took place nearly 13.6 million years ago. And now the universe is expanding due to this big bang theory. This is correct, but let me tell you, friends, this reason is not correct. It is factually incorrect. This reason is factually incorrect because the universe doesn't become highly opaque and temperature doesn't start increasing. In fact, the temperature dropped to a considerable degree after the big bang took place. So the answer is A is correct, but R is incorrect. So the C is the answer. So here is the explanation. So tiny ball with an imaginary small volume, infinite temperature and infinite density, a Big Bang took place in it nearly 13.7 billion years ago, and thus this is called as being Big Bang theory. So this is about your second question. Let's move on to the third question. Third question is, the terrestrial and Jovian planets are largely differentiated on the basis of loss of atmosphere from the former. Which of the following characteristics of terrestrial planets enable this loss of atmosphere? So here we have been asked that terrestrial and jovial planets are different on the basis of loss of atmosphere from the former. So terrestrial planets do not experience, do not have much atmosphere. So which of the following reasons explains this loss of atmosphere? We have to tell this. So the first is their large size as compared to most Jovian planets. Second, they're nearest to the sun, and the third is which of the above is correct. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that first is clearly wrong, because in fact terrestrial planets are smaller in size as compared to Jovian planets, so they are not larger. So certainly if they were of larger size, as the law of gravitation says, the more the mass a body has, or for that matter the size a body has, the more is the gravitational force of of exerted by that body. So in case if they had they been large had they been large in size, they would have atmosphere, they could have atmosphere on tied with them. Let me tell you friends that the reason is they're nearest to the sun, because the nearness to the sun, what it caused this gases to not consolidate into solid particles, solid matter. So that's why the gases were not able to consolidate themselves, and thus and also due to the reason of solar winds, strong solar winds, the atmosphere was kind of thrown away from these terrestrial land. So which of the above is correct? So only second is correct. So the answer would be B, that is two only. So the solution is B here. So as I've told you, so first is wrong because Jovian planets are in fact larger in size than terrestrial planets. Let's move on to the fourth question. Fourth question is, which of these may possibly influence circulation of ocean currents? First, the ocean water is little higher in level at equator than in the middle latitudes. Second, solar insolation affecting the temperature of ocean currents. So we have to choose which of the above is correct. So which of the above is responsible for the circulation of ocean currents? Let me tell you friends that the answer is both the statements are correct, because the ocean water is little bit higher at equator than in middle latitudes, and also this determines your counter equatorial current basically flows due to this higher latitude. And second is also correct, because ultimately the temperature affects the movement of ocean currents, and solar insolation affects the temperature. So that's why indirectly they affect the ocean currents. So the answer is both 1 and 2. So here is the solution. So here is justification. Near the equator, the ocean water is about 8 cm higher in level than in the middle latitudes, and solar energy makes current warm or cold and decides their circulatory pattern. So basically the surface currents are basically determined by wind, whereas the deep sea currents are determined by the density of the water and density differences, and also by the temperature differences in salinity variations. So these deep sea currents are responsible for the distribution of oxygen, nutrients and heat also. So occasional events also trigger serious currents, for example earthquake in the deep sea surface that may cause huge that may trigger devastating tsunamis. So let's move on to the fifth question. The fifth question is, Indian plate extends to first Rakhineoma Mountains of Myanmar, second Kirthar Mountains of Pakistan. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you friends that both of these is correct, because Kirthar Mountain of Pakistan basically forms this western boundary of the Pakistan the plate, and this the Kirthar Mountain of and Rakhineoma Mountains of Myanmar is basically it forms the eastern boundary of Indian plate. So both 1 and 2 are correct. So the solution is C. In east, it extends through Rakhineoma Mountains of Myanmar towards the island arc along the Java Trench, and the western margin follows Kirthar Mountain of Pakistan. The subduction zone along the Himalayas forms the northern plate boundary in the form of continent convergence. So this is about your this question, and here is explanation. So you can see here, this is Eurasian plate and this is Indian plate. So Eurasian plate and Indian plate merges with each other and results in the formation of huge kind of high altitude Himalayas, and this Kirthar mountain range is the western boundary, and this eastern boundary is this Rakhineoma mountains. So this is about your this question. Let's move on to the next question. Sixth question is, which of the following is correct order of decreasing abundance of these elements in the earth's crust? A, silicon, aluminium, iron, oxygen, calcium. B, silicon, iron, oxygen, calcium, aluminium. C, iron, oxygen, silicon, aluminium, calcium. D, oxygen, silicon, aluminium, iron, calcium. Let me tell you friends that you will be able to judge this question very easily, because oxygen is the largest in the earth's crust, followed by silicon, and then aluminium, and then iron, and then calcium. So solution is D. So it is a fact. So here is the explanation given. I have included the diagram here, so you can see that oxygen is largest in the earth crust, followed by silicon, aluminium, iron, calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium and others, and these eight to nine elements constitute 98% of the total crust of the earth. So elements in the Earth's crust are rarely found exclusively, but are usually found in combined form. Let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, it is a geological observation that there are more avalanches and landslides in Himalayas than in Nilgiri mountains of southern India. Which of these is not a possible reason for the same? So we have to choose that which of the above is not possible, is following is not the possible reason for the higher intensity of avalanches and landslides in Himalayas, and lower intensity and lower observation of avalanches and landslides in Nilgiri mountains. A. Himalayas are tectonically more active than Nilgiris. B. Mechanical weathering is absent in rocks found at Nilgiris due to their hard rock structure. C. Himalayas are characterized by unconsolidated rock deposits. D. All of the above are correct reasons for the same. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer here is B. Because A is a possible reason. Himalayas are more tectonically active because they are young fold mountains and they have formed during recent kind of period of geological history of Earth. So about the Nilgiris, Nilgiris are old. They are old. So that's why this the Himalayas are more tectonically active. And also, friends, the Himalayas are steep. Similarly, Nilgiris are also steep. But in fact, the Nilgiris have hard rock structure, so that doesn't result in much landslides or avalanches. But let me tell you, friends, that the mechanical weathering there takes place at a considerable rate due to the large variation in temperature and humidity is also high in this region of Nilgiri mountains. So B is not the answer. C is yes. Himalayas are characterized by unconsolidated rock deposit. So they have unconsolidated rock deposit. And D is simply all of the above are correct reasons. No, friends, the B is not the reason. So this is the answer. So basically, B is the answer because the three reasons mainly are tectonic activity and the gradient is steep in Himalayas and the rocks are unconsolidated and semi-consolidated. So let's move on to the eighth question. The eighth question is, the Aghuluhusk current acts as an oceanic convergence zone. This zone has higher primary productivity than surrounding waters. This is because, first, the zone is a meeting point of all major ocean currents of the Indian Ocean. Second, there is upwelling of cold ocean water from the lower layers of the ocean. Let me tell you, friends, that first is clearly wrong. This is not the zone where all of the ocean currents, Indian Ocean currents meet. So this is clearly wrong. First is wrong. But let me tell you, friends, that this region is characterized by higher primary productivity because there is continuous upwelling of cold water, which brings the nutrients and oxygen to the surface and from the lower surface of the ocean. So the answer is two only. That is B. So the answer is, solution is B. So convergence zone is basically a zone in the atmosphere where two prevailing flows meet. But clearly all the Indian Ocean currents do not meet at this zone. There is upwelling of cold nutrient-rich water south of the current. Additionally, the convergence tends to increase the concentration of plankton in and around Aghuluhusk. So here the convergence of cold, here the warm water and cold water currents meet. So that's why there is a kind of convergence. There is a moderate temperature there. So that results in the increasing concentration of plankton, and thus the primary productivity is higher there. So also this is especially notable in the Aghuluhusk retroflexion waters, where chlorophyll concentrations tend to be significantly higher than surrounding South Indian Ocean and South Atlantic Ocean waters. Let's move on to the ninth question. The ninth question is, the western coasts of India predominantly show which of these features? First, highly indented. Second, formation of wave cut platforms in the front of sea cliff. Let me tell you, friends, that both of these are the features that are seen in the western coasts of India because they are highly indented due to this ocean water currents, and also the formation of wave cut platforms in front of sea cliff. So the answer is both 1 and 2. Solution is C. So here is explanation. So western coast of India is a rocky coast, unlike the eastern coast, which is a low-lying sedimentary coast. So there, the slopes, rock structure and flow patterns are basically responsible for its rocky coast, and it is highly indented, and formation of wave cut platforms in the front of sea cliff is a common phenomena there. So let's move on to the 10th question. The 10th question is, equatorial countercurrents are unique because A. They flow in direction opposite to that of surface surface winds, B, they circulate from equator, the poles uninterrupted, to the poles uninterrupted. C, their travel speed is not affected by the ocean depth. D, they are the only current to be sandwiched between two eastward flowing ocean currents. So let me tell you, friends, we have to choose the correct answer, and the correct answer is A. They flow in a direction opposite to that of the surface wind. So equatorial countercurrent is unique due to this reason, because all the ocean currents, they move in the direction of the wind flow, but equatorial countercurrent is the only current that moves opposite to the direction of wind flow. So solution is A. So this basically the major surface flows that carry water eastward in the Atlantic Ocean, Indian and Pacific Oceans, they are basically equatorial countercurrents, and they are located near the equator and are sandwiched between two westward flowing currents, that is north equatorial current and the south equatorial current. And equatorial countercurrents are unique in that they flow in the opposite direction of the surface winds. So this is about your explanation. So here I have included the diagram. So here is north equatorial current, which is flowing westward, and south equatorial current, which is also flowing westward, and it in between these two is the equatorial countercurrent in the eastward direction. So answer is, as I have already told you, they are unique because they flow opposite the direction of wind. The 11th question is, consider the following statements about Mount Spirten volcano. First, it is the one of the most active volcanoes of Indonesia. Second, it was recently news due to its eruption. Third, it is located on Sulawesi Island of Indonesia. Let me tell you, friends, that all of these statements are correct. So all are correct. So the answer is D. So basically, this is a region. Indonesia, in fact, is located on Pacific Ring of Fire, which is the area where most of the volcanic eruptions occur. So this active volcano is located on Sulawesi Island in Indonesia. So also, friends, the importance about Indonesia is that it is at the meeting point of three major continental plates, that is Pacific, Eurasian and Indo-Australian plates. And Indonesia is also home to roughly 400 volcanoes, out of which 127 are currently active, accounting for about a third of the world's active volcanoes. Let's move on to the 12th question. 12th question is, consider the following statements about Pacific Ring of Fire. So here we have to consider certain statements about Pacific Ring of Fire. First, it is the region on Earth which experiences largest number of earthquakes and volcanoes. Second, the intensity, however, of earthquakes and volcanoes is not high in this region. Let me tell you, friends, that we have to choose the correct answer, and only first statement is correct, because the second is clearly incorrect. In fact, this Pacific Ring of Fire is a region where the largest number of earthquakes and volcanoes takes place, and also their intensity is quite high. So the answer is one only. So the solution is A. So Pacific Ring of Fire is basically, it is a region home to over 450 volcanoes, including three of the world's four most active volcanoes, that is Mount St. Helens in the USA, Mount Fuji in Japan, and Mount Pinatubo in Philippines. So it is sometimes also called the Circumpacific Belt. So around 90% of the world's earthquakes occur in Ring of Fire, and 80% of the world's largest earthquakes occur in this region. So there are a considerable number of countries that are at risk due to this Pacific Ring of Fire. So it has formed due to basically the subduction of oceanic plates below the continental plates. So this is about your this question, and it triggers earthquakes because they have deep trenches. So when the ocean plates subducts itself below the continental plate, and there is a large number of energy that is stored in this, and when this energy is released immediately, this causes earthquakes. So this is about your 13th question. So let's move on to the last question of the day. The last question is 14th question. Consider the following statements about winter solstice. First, it takes place in northern hemisphere on 21st December. Second, on this day, the sun is directly overhead the Tropic of Cancer. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that only first statement is correct. Yes, it takes place in northern hemisphere on 21 December. But this is wrong. It is wrong. Second statement is wrong. Why it is wrong? Because sun is directly over the Tropic of Capricorn on this day, and not over the Tropic of Cancer. So the answer is one only. A is the answer. So winter solstice is basically that thing in northern hemisphere when the sun is farthest from it. Sun is farthest from it. So it is over Tropic of Capricorn. So in other words, it is when the North Pole is tilted farthest away from the sun, delivering the fewest hours of sunlight of the year. So sun is directly overhead the Tropic of Capricorn in southern hemisphere, and not over the Tropic of Cancer. So this is about your explanation. But and in case of southern hemisphere, this winter solstice is called summer solstice because at that time sun is directly overhead Tropic of Capricorn. So sun is nearest to the people living in the southern hemisphere. So obviously the summer season is prevalent there. So this is about your explanation. So this is all about friends today's lecture. And basically solstice means the standing still, sun standing still. So these are the questions of today, friends. If you like the questions, if you like the video, then please do like it, share it with your friends, and please ensure that you subscribe to our channel. And also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications. Thank you, friends. Have a very nice day. Thank you very much.